HarperCollins presents Outback, the Desmond Bagley Centenary Thriller, written and read by Michael Davies. Author's note. I have something of a complicated relationship with Bill Kemp. I've now lived with him through two adventures, spread across the globe and almost 5 years, and he's been an entertaining companion. Described by Jeffrey Deaver as part James Bond, part Philip Marlowe, and all hero, he certainly gets himself into some interesting scrapes, and it's been a delight to bring a few more of them into the light for your enjoyment. And yet, he doesn't quite belong to me. Bill Kemp, albeit under a different name, was the creation of Desmond Bagley, one of the world's best-loved thriller writers through the 1960s, 70s and 80s. He initially appeared in Domino Island, a novel whose first draft was discovered in the archives 35 years after Bagley's death, and which was finally delivered to an excited public by his long-standing publishers HarperCollins in 2019. I had the privilege of editing, redrafting and polishing that early manuscript. We ended up calling it curating. And that was how I came to know and cherish Bill Kemp. I'd known and cherished Desmond Bagley a lot longer than that. My older brother Patrick reminds me that it was a teacher at school, Paul Wickham, who first introduced us to the thrills and spills of Bagley's novels. Running Blind, The Tightrope Men and The Enemy were particular favourites. When the opportunity arose to find ways of celebrating the centenary of Bagley's birth, I immediately knew that there was more to Bill Kemp that could be explored. His natural resourcefulness, military background, and sheer bloody-mindedness made him an ideal candidate for putting through the ringer in a new, original story that would aim not to mimic Bagley, but to pay modest tribute to the master and his legacy, 16 novels over a period of 18 years, until his early death aged just 59 in 1983. The project would never have come to fruition without the support, encouragement and hard work of a number of people. Foremost in that group comes David Braun, estates publisher at HarperCollins, who has nurtured the memory of Desmond Bagley, not least by keeping all his books in print, while juggling other behemoths such as J.R.R. Tolkien, Agatha Christie, and Alistair MacLean. David's assiduous care of Bagley's literary legacy is a mark both of his professional excellence and of his love of the work, and I suspect his deceased authors owe him just as much a debt as this living one does. David was kind enough to bestow upon me the wonderful editor Sophia Schopfer, whose perspicacity and attention to detail have contributed considerably to the finished novel. Along the way, the ever-generous Paul Campbell offered terrific advice, while another keeper of the Bagley flame, Nigel Alefounder, has always been on hand with an encouraging word. I urge you to pay a visit to his highly informative website at desmondbagley.blogspot.com, as well as Philip Eastwood's comprehensive biographical one, thebagleybrief.com. Outside the publishing world, I was lucky enough to enjoy a brief but joyous correspondence with Bagley's widow, Joan, before her own death in 1999. Fortunately for me, Joan's sister, Licia, and her husband, Peter, have in the years since made me feel a very welcome part of the Bagley story, and theirs is a friendship I continue to cherish. Their love and inspiration have been major factors in my ongoing Bagley obsession, and I hope they will feel I have done the family justice with my tribute. There is, of course, another person without whom this novel would never have happened. For Desmond Bagley, known to friends and family as Simon for reasons unclear, his wife Joan provided an intellectual sounding board, a safe space in which to play with his stories, and an invaluable first read editor. Indeed, she herself prepared two of his manuscripts for posthumous publication. I have been blessed with my own equivalent, in the shape of my wife, Tricia, who has supported and enabled the book to be written. Thank you for being you. Oh, and if you're wondering about Bill Kemp's original name, there's a story. Bagley christened him Robert Armin, after a member of the troupe of actors for whom Shakespeare wrote and performed. While I was working on Domino Island, my sense was that the name Armin was too similar to the notorious Ugandan dictator Idi Amin and might prompt some unhelpful associations in the mind of the reader. So instead, I borrowed the name of another Shakespearean colleague for our hero. Bagley had explicitly given permission for the book to be retitled. He'd even invited suggestions, so I didn't feel too uncomfortable about tweaking the protagonist's name as well. I hope Desmond Bagley fans around the world will afford me as much generosity with Outback, my centenary tribute to the great man, as they did with Domino Island, my cheeky collaboration with him. For Tricia, for real this time. And for my boys, Matthew, Ethan, Alex, and Oliver. Part 1. Blue. 1. The first thing that hit me was the coolness of the interior. After the blazing heat of the sand, which weighted down your shoulders like a wet astrakhan, it thumped you with a wall of cold. The second thing was the utter blackness. Forget adjusting your eyes for a couple of minutes in an unlit room. This was darkness such as I'd never known, even in the depths of the jungle at night. At least there, some creatures emit glimmering hints of their nocturnal activity. Here, contrasted with the searing whiteness of the sun outside, the mine was a void. I stumbled blindly forward for as many paces as the rocks underfoot would allow without serious injury, and squatted on my haunches. I was reluctant to look behind me for fear of destroying my retinas with another blast of dizzying light, but I could hear Sophie and Adam clattering among the looser stones at the entrance. "Bloody hell, it's dark," said Adam simply. "Watch your footing," I said. "It'll take a while for our eyes to adapt, so I'd stay put if I were you." The clattering stopped, and we waited. Even here, a mere 10 yards into the mouth of the mine, the daylight from outside was growing thin and opaque, while the blackness within yawned like a sleeping giant. "What can you see?" Sophie's voice reverberated as it fell into the depths of the chamber in front of us. "Not a damn thing," I said. "Can you shine your torch into the shaft?" She cursed under her breath, the whisper following her question into the dark. "I left it in the landy." My heart sank. Without the torch, we hadn't got a chance of scoping out the mine as we'd intended. There was nothing for it but to go back to the Land Rover at the bottom of the hill and pick it up. I ransacked my brain to see if there was anything else we might have left behind. If someone was going back to the car, they might as well make it worthwhile. "I'll go," said Sophie, preempting my offer to play the White Knight. As the most qualified member of the team, I could have overridden her, but along with my seniority came the disadvantages of great age. I had a good 15 years on her. There was also my natural aversion to extreme temperatures, and the mercury was already comfortably, or more accurately, uncomfortably, above the 100-degree mark in the afternoon sun. "Bring some more water, will you? There's no telling how long we'll be down here." Sophie's boots scuttled back up towards the entrance, and I heard her exchange a few words with Adam as she passed him on the way out. I don't know what his excuse was not to exercise a little chivalry and offer to go back to the car instead, but moments later he was lowering himself into the steep mouth of the shaft. He was barely 3 yards behind me when I felt the ground shift beneath my feet. A cascade of loose stones swept down from where Adam was manoeuvring and took away the tentative foothold I'd established. Instinctively, I threw my arms sideways and tried to grab a handful of earth, but instead I fell backwards and landed heavily on my rump, the miniature landslide carrying me on uncontrollably. "Keep still!" I yelled into the darkness and heard my own voice yelling back. I couldn't have slid more than a few feet, but it was enough to scare me. I'd read about the original miners who plumbed shafts with pickaxes and lowered themselves into timber-lined holes with windlasses in the search for precious metals, and I knew the death toll had been high. I also knew that one of the legacies of those early century prospectors was a landscape peppered with hidden shafts and tunnels that could entrap the unwary and literally bury them alive. While I was pretty confident Sophie's ancestors were unlikely to have dug a network of underground caverns in this remote corner of the South Australian desert, I'd just as soon not find out the hard way that I was wrong. I lay still for a full 2 minutes before daring to twist my head round. Adam was silhouetted against the mouth of the shaft, the edge of his form blurred by the shocking blue of the sky beyond.
"Bill, are you okay?"
"I'm fine, but don't move. The ground is unstable, and I really don't want to go any further in without a torch. Or a rope, come to that."
"Sophie shouldn't be long. She's got the rope tied round her waist."
"Looks like we're just going to have to sit it out, then." I stared up at the ceiling of the tunnel, my eyes now finally beginning to make out some of the crevices and curves of the chiselled and blasted rock face. At a height of more than 12 feet, it felt more like a galleried hall than the entrance to a mine, but the wide opening was designed to prevent collapse. Further in, the shaft was sure to get increasingly narrow and claustrophobic. My mind wandered to the pioneers whose quest for untold wealth had driven them to this wilderness and a life of desolation and danger. I knew from previous encounters with the unimaginably wealthy that riches could do strange things to people. It seemed that the desire for riches could be just as corrosive.
"Seeing any clearer now?"
"Starting to," said Adam. "It's still pretty oppressive down here."
"And we're only a few yards in. Imagine what it must be like half a mile underground."
"I'm not sure I want to. This is Sophie's adventure, not mine."
I snorted in the darkness. "Missing the comforts of the home counties?"
"Something like that. I could be sitting in a nice cosy office, wrapped up in a warm sweater, reading personnel files right now."
My thoughts flitted briefly to the dismal politicking and the prospects of power cuts and a 3-day week that I'd left behind in England when I got on the 747 to Sydney.
"You're not telling me you'd prefer the grim grey British winter to this Australian heatwave, are you?"
"Pros and cons, Bill, pros and cons. You don't seem overjoyed to be here yourself. I thought someone with your background would be in their element in this kind of environment."
He was right. Most military men would give their right arm to find themselves in my position right now. What with the dramatic location, hint of derring-do, and flirtation with danger, albeit in a heavily sanitised, strictly English kind of way, this would be a dream posting for many, perhaps most, of my former colleagues. But I had discovered since leaving uniform that I was not your run-of-the-mill ex-soldier at something of a loss in Civvy Street. For a while, I'd found a nice little niche investigating dodgy claims for a global insurance company, which had not only taken me all over the world, but also introduced me to some extremely interesting people. Some of them I might even be willing to run into again.
"It's the heat I can't stand," I offered lamely.
"You're better off in here, then."
I could feel my left leg going numb. When I'd slipped and sat heavily down on the loose rock, I'd ended up putting my body weight on my left-hand side, and now my buttock was feeling the effects. I tried to stabilise my right foot flat on the floor of the shaft and adjusted my centre of gravity away from the pins and needles. As I lifted myself clear of the shale, it moved again, and I felt the whole plate of rock on which I was lying shift. There was a movement above me, and a shower of shingle fell around my ears. Adam was trying to shuffle down to grab me, but it was the wrong move.
"Stay where you are!"
The movement stopped, and so did the gravel waterfall.
"If this loose stuff becomes any more unstable, we'll both go head first down the shaft," I said. "And we don't know how much steeper it gets. It could be vertical for all we know."
"Sorry,
I was just trying to help.
Thanks for the thought, I said, feelingly, and lapsed into an anxious silence. Where the hell was Sophie? I really needed her with the torch and rope before things got any worse. Adam was obviously thinking the same thing. What's taking us?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.